I am repeating, feminism is not a singular or unitary concept, but a polyvalent amalgam of diverse, multi-layered, complex, and often contradictory ideas. Therefore, the different views of feminism may not express the same idea, and there could be contradictions in these ideas. So there are some books which discusses feminism in general, but now I am reading from Urmila Mukhopadhyay's book, Feminisms. Before we come to any general definition of feminism, one may point out that the term was first used in 1871 as a medical term to define symptoms of feminization of the bodies of male patients. So I am going to use the blackboard. The French novelist Alexandre Dumas in 1872 uses an expression in a pamphlet, L'Homme Femme. Femme means woman, homme means man. So by this term, Dumas meant women who behave in a masculine way. Masculine women, used by Alexandre Dumas, a famous novelist, in 1872. Virginia Woolf, we all know, is a great 20th century female writer. Through her novels, we find the importance of demands of women are very strongly represented. But initially, she had some reservations about the term feminism. Then, in the 1848, there was a convention in America where it was called the Seneca Falls Convention, and then a declaration of sentiments. All these movements spearheaded the question of women's rights. The you know, at that time, the Declaration of American Independence or the rights of American citizens, these were all debated, and simultaneously the rights of women were also being debated. So we have in the 18th century in America and England a few authors who spoke for women's rights, like Mary Wollstonecraft. The date is 1792. So these are path-breaking works at the very beginning of the idea of feminism. And feminism is, the history of feminism is related by referring to different waves of feminism, like first wave, second wave, third wave, and so on. So, what are these waves of feminism? The first wave, for example, it is used to signify the feminist movements of the late 19th century and the early 20th century. That were aimed at acquiring equal rights for women. So basically, fight for equal rights for women. So this is the original intention, you may say, that was the original intention behind the first wave feminism. Second wave feminism refers to the feminist movements of the 1960s and 70s. So this is first wave. Second wave. Also the role of women in time. Female rights. You may say roughly that is the second wave. So, apart from there is also third wave and other waves, but we will look at them later. But apart from a discussion of feminism in terms of waves, there is also a classification of principally three kinds of feminism. And they are broadly liberal feminism, Marxist or socialist feminism, and radical feminism. So if you look at the Wikipedia entry of feminism, you will see that it runs into 55 or more pages. Liberal Marxist, or socialist, feminism, and radical feminism. So these are the three main broad categories of feminism. But today we can speak of various other kinds of feminism. But before that, let me explain these terms, liberal, Marxist, radical, and so on. So, the liberal feminists, they argue for equal rights of women.
কি বললেন?
Three categories. Broad categories under which feminism may be classified. Okay. So liberal feminism is about fight for equal rights of women, which we saw in the first wave feminism mostly, and they are not so much against patriarchy. Marxist or socialist feminism, it is, they believe that it is the class domination and class struggle, or the capitalist mode of production, which is responsible for the condition of women, or briefly, capitalism is held as the factor responsible for the evils of women. And radical feminists identify patriarchy to the rule of all evil. They are against patriarchy. We'll later define the term patriarchy. Therefore, the earlier feminists, the first wave liberal feminists, they fought for equal rights of women, but they did not analyze in this fashion, like the Marxists, that that the capitalistic mode of production was responsible for the women's condition, or like the radical feminists, that patriarchy is responsible for all evils in the condition of women. Apart from these three broad categories, today we can speak of some other kinds of feminism.
Sir, ওই ফিমেল রাইটস ফ্যামিলির পরের ওয়ার্ডটা কি?
ফ্যামিলি সেক্সুয়ালিটি. সরি অ্যাবাউট দিস. সো ক্যান আই ইনকোয়ার প্লিজ?
Yes, sir.
Speak about other kinds of feminism, particularly after the modern theories of structuralism, post-structuralism, post-modernism, these became available. Then there is psychoanalytic feminism. Structural feminism, and there are many more, like cyber feminism, eco feminism, and so on. I'm not going to write all of these. So now we have to understand that feminism was intimately tied with different political movements, like the movement of universal suffrage. Extended to women in England, between England and other countries, European countries, between 1928 and 1948. That women got voting rights in England and other countries. Some countries, it was even much later that they were the voting rights. Among the important philosophers who brought to the fore the importance of women and their status, or we may say the woman question, as we said today. Mary Wollstonecraft, I have already indicated, John Stuart Mill, subjection of women. Legal or political rights and had restricted access to higher education. Queen Elizabeth ascended the throne in 1558 and reigned successfully over a long period. Subsequent political events such as the English Civil War and the Glorious Revolution of 1688 destabilized the sovereignty of the monarch. There were also tentative attempts challenging patriarchal rule. And then some early women writers began to challenge patriarchal rule. So, beginning from the 16th century, women writers started voicing the rights of women and against the subjection of women. So, in the Renaissance, for example, there is female writer named Afra Ben. I think it is in your syllabus. Her novel Orun. Afra. Women's movements gained momentum under the banner of women's liberation. So we get another phrase, women's liberation. Second World War or during the Second World War, women were forced to join many activities like working in factories, also sometimes they joined as soldiers and so on. So gradually various fields opened to women. Then in America there was the civil rights movement and the anti-Vietnam War movements. These movements are also allied to the women's rights movements. Uh, The second wave was, however, far-reaching, with women not only demanding political and legal equality, but also control over their reproductive and sexual roles. So, as I had written, sexuality, the role in the family. So, the idea that a woman should have control over her body and over her sexuality, that idea was brought forward by the second wave movement. And with that, there came to be a distinction between the terms sex and gender. Roughly speaking, originally people thought that sex was biological, natural, and gender was, on the other hand, cultural. So for some time, that was the distinction made between sex and gender. And therefore, insofar as gender is cultural or conditioned by culture, there was a scope of imagining a different gender role for women. Because if sex was natural or biological, people thought that nothing much can be done in this area because it was biologically determined. But as far as gender was considered as culturally determined, that is, the idea that the child learns to behave in a particular way as a female, and male children are encouraged to behave in a different way. So, male and female notions of gender, they are culturally produced. So, people thought that therefore there was a scope for culturally making the roles equal rather than one subservient to the other. But sex, insofar as it was natural, it was considered that nothing can be done in this area. But later, when sexual change of sex with the help of surgery, these technologies were developed, then people did not believe in this part also, that sex is biologically determined and therefore it can never be changed or controlled. So nowadays, for example, people think of sex also being largely culturally determined and a very complex term. So we can discuss these terms, sex and gender, in a greater detail later. Androgyny was upheld as an ideal mode of experience for both men and women by some radical feminists, and so on. Now, androgyny, we will discuss this term also later. Androgyny, you know, is the concept of those who have ambiguous sex, and like hermaphrodites, and andros means male, gyne, that is the sex or gender. So this concept, that is when women can behave like men, radical feminists thought that that was a way of emancipation of women, when women may behave like men. But this idea was not accepted by everybody. the ideas of masculine and feminine in the concept of androgyny, masculine is valorized. That is, being masculine is better than being feminine. But all feminists do not agree with that, because femininity in itself cannot be imagined as inferior. Therefore, there are women who want to uphold femininity, and they do not support the glorification of masculinity. Then, on the question of motherhood, because women have traditionally been praised as mothers, or the ideal of women as mothers, this valorization of motherhood, that is actually a development of patriarchy, an idea raised by patriarchy. And many feminists were divided on the issue of motherhood. Now, the radical libertarian and the radical cultural feminists, they are divided on this issue. Radical libertarian and radical cultural feminist. Radical libertarian feminists and radical cultural feminists. So these two groups. The radical libertarians thought that women should have absolute freedom of choice vis-à-vis motherhood. On the question of motherhood, women should have absolute choice. Whereas radical cultural feminists, they thought that motherhood should be celebrated and valorized. Therefore, some people want to celebrate motherhood, the radical cultural feminists celebrate motherhood. And the libertarian, they think that women should not be forced to become mothers, or motherhood should not be unnecessarily glorified. Women should be free to choose whether they want to be mothers or not. So they emphasized the question of choice on this subject. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
The Marxists and socialists, we know that they insisted that women's oppression is a result of capitalism. In a deeply classist society, patriarchy is inevitable. To to instill gender equality, both patriarchy and capitalism should be dismantled. So you remember the three broad categories of feminists, the Marxists and socialists, they are the second group, and the radicals, they are the third group. Now the radicals blame everything on patriarchy, and Marxists and socialists blame everything on capitalism. Therefore, they are also divided on this issue. Later, we may say, in the 20th century, with the development of critical theories in psychoanalysis, after Freud, Jacques Lacan, the French thinker, developed psychoanalysis further. But when feminists began to study psychoanalysis, then they found that both Freud and Lacan, they are culpable because it seems that they have some patriarchal ideas. They turn their inquiry inwards, unlike liberal, radical, Marxist or socialist feminists. They try to analyze the forms and structures of oppression as internalized and expressed in the psyche. So they thought that men's or women's psyche interiorizes psychoanalytical feminists in the figures of Julia Kristeva and Ellen Sixous. These are important 20th and even today 21st century. Julia Kristeva, she is actually a Bulgarian but she writes in French. These two, they are still living, modern psychoanalytical feminists. So they have contributed in this area, but they principally write in French. So they provide a critique of Freudian and Lacanian psychology. Lacanian then post-colonial, from the post-colonial point of view also we might see feminist movements. They subvert the monistic myth of the category of woman, underlying the varieties of female experience across caste, class, race and sexuality.
Yes. Men's, women's psyche for ki likhe chen bujhte pachhi na.
Interiorizes criteria.
Okay sir, thank you.
So, post-colonial and multicultural feminism. Because you know that from a post-colonial point of view, women may be divided into groups like the women of the developed country and the women of the colonized countries. They do not have the same status. Okay. Woman, this term woman. Does not mean the same thing in developed and developing countries. So, from a post-colonial point of view, similarly, multicultural point of view, women are divided according to class, caste, race, and so on. Therefore, the status of a black woman is not the same as that of a white woman, or the status of a woman of higher caste is not the same as that of a lower caste. Therefore, multicultural feminists, they take into account all this. The post-colonial feminists, they speak of women of the developed countries, women of the developing countries or undeveloped countries. Therefore, the category woman is subdivided by them or broken into various subcategories by them, by their analysis. So they speak of a plurality of women's material reality. So, the first wave of feminism was about women's rights, equal rights, political rights, voting rights and so on. The second wave of feminism was about sexuality, role of women in the family, sex and gender and so on. And now we come to the third wave of feminism, which is ideas from postmodern feminism, and from the point of postmodernism, it attacks the binaries of masculine and feminine, sex and gender. Third wave feminism. Binaries masculine, feminine. Sex. That these binaries, they are born out of patriarchy. They assert the importance of difference in speaking, thinking and writing for and about women. Then in the 1980s, we have the idea of post-feminism, that is, whether feminism is already something past, and whether in the new reality there should not be any discussion about feminism per se, but about the new role of women in society. So this is called post-feminism. But it is still debated idea and not accepted by everybody. New idea. Okay. So we mostly looked at the history of feminism and the different waves of feminism. And even though all feminists, they speak against the oppression of women and speak in favor of women's rights, but they have, their theories are based on different grounds, so multiple ways of looking at the thing, and therefore in general, we may say that the broad terms sex and gender, masculine and feminine, these terms today have been questioned, and feminists want more and more in-depth analysis and therefore consequent change in our philosophical attitude on the woman question. So I'll stop here. If you have any questions, you can